Training was difficult and people were tired. And I think that that's still kind of a theme that we see throughout our organizations. And I started to question, how can a therapist create a wellness experience for a guest if they're not feeling well themselves? So that led me to start to hearken back to my first life, which was hospital administration, and I spent 25 years doing that. Started off in human resources and worked my way up into operations and became a chief operating officer. And I was always interested in organizational culture. Went back and got my master's degree in organization behavior from Loyola University in Chicago, and studied with some of the greats like Peter Block and some of the great thinkers of our time. And so that's a passion of mine and something that I really love. So today, in a very quick time frame, because this is going to be a roundtable discussion as well, we'll just look at the employee landscape and what's going on with the research today. And then the work ahead to me is synchronizing employee wellness with organizational wellness. And we have a strategy and a method for doing that. How to begin the journey if you're interested in creating that well culture yourself in the organization, or even refining your culture, fine-tuning it, finding some element that you'd like to amplify in some way. So here's a few statistics that are very relevant and recent. So Forbes Advisor published a study on May 18th of this year. So 60% of HR departments have prioritized leadership development as essential to improving productivity, loyalty, and satisfaction of work. How many of you know that your boss has a huge influence on your motivation at work? It's actually the number one reason why employees leave companies. Number one reason. 45% of employees are burned out by organizational changes on top of daily responsibilities. So for those of you who have all of that hard work to gain that Forbes recognition and those Forbes programs, that's one element of it. We keep layering more and more and more on top of people. And the average employee's reaction to that is, here we go again, right? So how do we engage and how do we actually involve them in becoming part of that organization? Churn did a study, and on average, it costs $4,100 to onboard an employee once you leave. And it takes 6 months to break even on that investment. Start multiplying that. There's another study done by Business Week which suggests that one third of the employee's salary will not be recouped until 6 months of employment. So it takes one third of the salary to actually bring them back up to speed for a new employee. So companies with structured onboarding programs keep about 58% of employees for an average of 3 years. So what I notice in my own company is that that onboarding is so critical in making sure that they understand not only their role, but how do they fit into that broader picture and the mission of the organization. 30% of employees leave their job within 90 days. 32% of those cite company culture is the reason why. So, we all have our own models of wellness, and I think they're all excellent, and it honestly doesn't matter what model you have. It's important to stick with what model you have so that you're not constantly changing and it becomes the next program of the day. One that we use that I like is four dimensions: spiritual, emotional, physical, and intellectual. So those four components are what makes for a well person. So today the talk is a little bit heady, so we're sitting in kind of that intellectual space right now. Obviously great speakers can tap into that emotional space as well. And then we know the physical aspect because most wellness programs originally started as a nutrition or a physical type of exercise program. Outside of that is our next dimension. Once we get that in order, we look to our relational dimension. So how, once I feel good about myself, I am much more capable of interacting with my guests, with my peers, and my team members. So then all of those relational skills come into play. And outside of that, so it's, if you think of dropping a pebble in the water, it just kind of keeps expanding out. Outside of that is our ecosystem stewardship, so sustainability, our reserving financial resources, and also our global citizenship, being part of our communities, being part of the world around us. Well, that led me to think about, well, how does that translate into an organizational model for wellness? So spiritual all of a sudden becomes societal duties. So what are the things that I'm doing in my community to help others actually aspire to be great? Brand promise and culture become that emotional component. Because I can tell you, guests do not resonate with the mission on the wall. They do not resonate with words. They resonate with connection. They resonate with the heart. So how do we connect with them? So our brands live on that emotional element. The physical bringing of things into the world is our architectural builds, our environments, the built environment, and we'll be talking about that this afternoon, the importance of built environment and architecture. Also the interior design of a building, and then the systems, how do we structure work? Margaret, I hope you'll share your schedule of how you have employees scheduled throughout the day, because I think it's revolutionary. One of the things that I know is that that churn, that mill, I owned a spa myself and was a spa operator for 8 years, of just churning rooms, getting ready for the next treatment. How do I regain my composure before I approach that next guest? So all of those things, how we structure work, that's all part of that dimension. And then business intelligence. So the collective intelligence of what we're learning, what we're growing into. Each of us brings our own natural skill set and wisdom to the organization, and then how do we cultivate that? Because every time we lose someone in the organization, we lose a piece of that intelligence as well. So then the relationship building becomes networking and community development, and still stewardship of the environment, our financial resources, and global citizenship is the same on both models, because we live in the same world, whether or not we're an individual or we're an organization. So when these two align, it's my belief is that we'll finally have an organization where people are really excited to work. And what's interesting about that, there's a lot of detail, but I'm not going to go into it, so there's several subsections. And what we've done under the foundation is we've developed an employee instrument that can be taken by employees and all employees in the organization, including senior leadership, and then comparing the answers to those. And so we delve a little bit deeper into each of these dimensions to see how well we fare in each of them. The interesting part, as I mentioned about sustainability, is it's universal. It's universal to my own personal wellness, being a responsible citizen myself, and it's also universal to the organization as well. So culture is a really funny thing, and we think we can change it really easily, but it's a very complex animal. It's squishy, it's oozy. You think you make a dent in it, and all of a sudden it bounces back in a different way that you don't really anticipate. So for me, it's helpful to look at culture, and this is based on Edgar Schein's work. And Edgar Schein was a great organizational psychologist. He was actually born in, I believe, 1928, and he just died on January 26th of this year. But in 1986, he talked about culture needs to be understood in terms of levels, because if you ever want to make a dent in it, you have to have really concrete strategies to attack it. So we have the first level, which is called optics. So optics are the things that we see in the environment. So when I look around the room, how might this room give me an impression of what the culture is of this organization?
Jared's outfit.
Sorry?
Optics, is that what you're saying?
So, yeah, like just the any visual artifacts that are in the room, the lighting, the fixtures, the carpet. So what cues does this give you about the culture of this organization at the Grand Geneva?
Traditional?
Pardon?
Traditional,
right. We see the pretty traditional carpet, the woods, heavier woods. So it gives you a real, like a feeling of what the organization is about. If you walk into a glass building with lots of greenery and lots of light, it gives you a different feel than when you walk into something that's more traditional. So the second level is patterns of behavior. So these are patterns that we see in the environment. So if it's not an individual behavior, but it's the collective pattern. So if you walk up to a front desk and you see a guest associate say, excuse me, I'll be right with you. Thank you so much for your patience. When they're working with someone, that's going to give you, if you see it multiple times in the organization, all of a sudden you've got a picture of what a really great pattern of behavior is in this organization. And I was thinking, Michael, to your standards of the overall guest experience, I would imagine those are the kind of things that you're looking for, those interactions and those guest experiences that are consistent across the organization and not necessarily just an isolated event. Assumptions are assumptions that we make about anything. So, and we have lots of assumptions. Well, that'll never work. Oh, we've tried that before. I don't know if you've heard some of those sayings in your organization when you introduce a new idea or concept, but those are based on some type of assumption in the organization or an experience that an employee has had. At the deeper level, we go to values. So do my values align with the organization? Our values for One Well World are love, learn, lead, and laugh. And I can tell you on Indeed, when I ask an employee why they're applying for our company, 86% will say it's because of your values and it's on the job description. So I think that employees are really looking to organizations today. And actually there's another study that says 96% of employees go to a company's website and they go to their Yelp and they look at ratings of the organization. If there's low ratings, they don't necessarily want to apply for that organization. So everything's becoming much more transparent today. Beliefs are at a very deep level. We see it in our country today. Different beliefs about anything from topics like abortion to any of the political issues that we're plagued with today. And I can tell you, if my beliefs are entrenched, I don't want to hear you. I don't want to listen to you, and I don't want to even consider anything else. So if you're in a traditional organization that's been doing things well for a long time, it's really tough to think about changing or introducing new changes. And finally, at the lowest level, it's what we call the collective unconscious. We don't even know, it's so deep, but it's underpinnings that really hold the organization where it is. It's like, I don't want you to move. You know, you take a step forward, and I like to think of it as, if you've ever gone crabbing on the East Coast, what they do is they dig a pit in the sand and they'll throw like the crabs in. And what happens is if you throw one in, it'll scurry out and it'll go back to the ocean. If you throw more than one in, as one tries to crawl out, the other crab actually grabs onto it and pulls it back down. So I like to use that analogy about how difficult sometimes it is to tackle organizations. So that said, we're going to have a little exercise at the moment, but I wanted to just say there's only two dimensions that are above the surface that we can actually cognitively see and do something about. The rest of them are much lower and tougher to address. So as you go down, it becomes harder, but it also becomes more substantial. So if I change something at the belief system where I challenge a belief or want to look at your belief or help you see my belief a little bit differently, that's going to have a deeper impact than the superficial impacts in an organization.